I can't take one more step towards you. 'Cause all that's waiting is regret. Don't you know I'm not your ghost anymore? You lost the love I love the most. I learned to live half a life, and now you want me one more time. Think you are running around leaving scars, collecting your jar of hearts and tearing love apart. You're gonna catch a cold from the ice inside your soul. Don't come back for me. Who do you think you are? Yeah, you're asking all around if I am anywhere to be found. But I have grown too strong to ever fall back. To live half a life, and now you want me one more time.
Welcome.
Well, it's a little sad.
Well.
It's a little sad.
Scooch a little bit, brother.
Welcome to Wildfire Live Stream number 51. As Jade Robertson checking in, how are you?
Nicholas Jansen, I'm doing well. How are you?
Thanks for everybody joining. We've got
so much.
Crush Leather,
welcome.
K Merks,
welcome.
VK 70, Nick Mirka, Angelica Falco, hello. Greg Holmes, hey guys.
Oh, Greg.
Hey y'all.
He's here for his contractual appearance.
Yep. Thanks for everybody for showing up, and it's good to have you here. We've got some tales from the Ale Trail going to be happening shortly over here, but without further ado, I'm thinking we'll introduce our guest.
Let's talk about it. Let's do it.
So, ladies and gentlemen, we're firing up another one. This week, we're super stoked to welcome actor, director, producer, filmmaker, amateur bureologist, and accidental entrepreneur. We'll just stick with Idea Factory for now. Nick Mirka.
Born and raised in the great city of St. Catharines.
Shout out.
Nick is a graduate of the Toronto Film School with a degree in digital film and television production. There, he met his BFF, Mark, and together, they created Mitchell Riley Pictures, or MRP for short.
MRP!
They started making short films and music videos, and silly little things. Over the years, they evolved into a full-blown video production company that specializes in dynamic commercials, documentaries, and web series.
Their company is constantly evolving. They used to film weddings and home tours and have gotten busier with commercial work. Some notable projects that they're pleased to let us know about would be their 35 years of BC VQA with the British Columbia Wine Institute, and their quirky explainers for Rocky Mountain Barber Company, Just Jump, Penn Financial Credit Union, just to name a few. They continue to pursue creative avenues like their feature-length documentary on Sonic Onion Records and their comedic traveling craft beer show, Tales from the Ale Trail, hence the ales. And every so often, they need to make a silly video for the internet for some good old giggles.
Well, it's going to be great to bring Nick onto the show, and we're going to discuss everything from his epic career journey, a few of our overlapping connections within the Niagara scene, and perhaps beer tasting or two or three.
We have the beer. Well, without further ado,
slide in a little more.
Yeah, I'm going to play some guitar. Do you want to click send request?
Yeah, I'd love to.
One, two.
Here he is.
Hello.
Hey!
Gentlemen, how are you?
Good. How are you?
Good. Just trying to set up my my positioning here.
Thank you for taking the time to be honest here.
Oh my goodness. Thank you for having me. I mean, in a pandemic, it's so nice to just have conversations with people over the age of six. So.
It's been a different ball game for everybody involved. It's kind of crazy. I don't know. We're all sort of getting through it, I suppose, or Yeah. What have you been up to, man, since COVID and everything, and how's it going?
Oh, you know, the thing I keep saying about this time is there's this universal acceptance that we're all in this together. So when you're like, how's it going? Oh, you know, good. You're like, I know what you mean by that. Like, I legitimately know what you mean. There's not like, hey, I'm having like the best month of my life while you're having your worst. We're all just kind of languishing through life a bit. But no, like things are good. Like our company keeps motoring on, and I feel like I'm more of a therapist, from a commercial standpoint, like working with clients who just are dealing with heartbreak and headaches and shutdowns and like even like businesses that are like, are we going to exist in a year? So, that can be tough. But then just on a personal note, it's like, you get a lot of time with your family, and like, I have three kids at home, and it's just, it's nuts. It's nuts. I could use a babysitter. But at the same time, like, I mean, my kids are 6, 4, and 2 now. At the beginning of this, they're 5, 3, and 1. So they're only going to be this little for so long, right? It's not like this is the most busy, most dependent age of their lives. Yeah, so. How about you guys? How have you guys been keeping sane?
This
has been a big part of it. Just a weekly thing we come to, put the prep in. We, you know, find different people to talk to. I think it's been good for both of us to just keep going.
That's awesome, man. Are you guys roommates?
Yeah.
We are, yeah.
I love that.
So,
my goodness.
We moved in right like a month before everything shut down. So we've basically just been like COVID roommates.
So you are each other's person. Like, it's like, okay. No wonder you need to bring somebody on every week.
We have a third guy. His name's Matt, and he's an editor and a great guy too. And he's come into a few live streams here and there just to poke his head in. But we should have a formal interview with him and go through his editing career and all that sort of stuff. But we've got some things in front of us. We've got
sure.
Over the course of your this done on the go.
Yes. You know what? While I was just waiting for the warm up, I thought I'd crack one open. So yeah. Give it a go. Are you guys sharing? You splitsies?
Yeah, Nick's going to have this glass.
Cool. So, good. That's a very generous pour for him. Okay, good. So, guys, on the ale trail, whenever we would taste beer, we tried to make the whole beer tasting a little bit more approachable, less like, oh yeah, is that Sabro hops? That's not what we do here. So when we tried beer, we wanted to characterize it in a way that we'd all understand. So we like to profile a beer with a celebrity. So when you're drinking this Innocent Gun, think about the characters and the feelings it makes you feel. And then just if you think of someone who comes to mind, you let me know. Cheers, guys.
Cheers. To Tales from the Ale Trail. A killer Bell 5 series out of Niagara.
Totally. Oh. Innocent Gun is like a fridge staple. Like, have you guys had this before?
I have not.
Okay.
I'm not a beer drinker, so this is from an outsider's perspective.
Oh, hence this tiny glass.
Hence the tiny glass, but...
For pun's sake, nice. I wanted to say James Gunn, but I'm... No. No.
You know what? You may just not have found the right beer. A lot of people don't like profile beer, but like there's such a wide palate. It's like saying I don't like candy or sandwiches. It's like there will be a sandwich for you. There may be a beer for you. What do you think of this one?
Not bad. Which celebrity? I don't know. I've never thought about it.
I'm thinking Harrison Ford.
Oh, that's a good one.
With a name like Innocent Gun, I mean, I'm sort of the name and the description and the fact that it's a bourbon barrel scotch ale, like it's got a lot of character and notes that are, you know, built over time. It's not just, I mean, my understanding, scotch is very, you know, refined and it's, you know, time, but beer takes time.
Can be. Yeah. Oh, yeah. No. I know that Harrison Ford would be a good one. It's smooth too, like the Scotch ale and like even the bourbon barrels, like just make it a smoother beer. There's a lot of rich character in it. Like I could totally see the Harrison Ford that you're picking up. I was thinking like this one, it's got some sweetness too and a lot of character. It's kind of unexpected. It's not your normal beer. I was going to go with Chris O'Dowd for me. You know, I think most people would like him.
Just for all those who don't know who Chris O'Dowd is, I'm just going to give you a quick rundown here.
Oh my, how do you have that?
The power of the internet.
Okay, it's power of the internet. I was like, is that a poster in your guys' apartment? Did I tap into something I didn't know about you two? Oh, there you go.
I hope the next one's Edward Norton.
I'm ready. Amazing.
We wanted to sort of break bread a little bit and kind of go into some of our connections on how we know one another. I'll let Nick start that one.
Well, I believe you actually directed me at one point in time.
Oh my goodness. You're the marker flip.
This was my claim to fame for a long time.
You know what? That was in our group. You are epic. Like, cause it's that it was a video for those of you who don't know what he just showed, that is a video for the DSBN called Sky's the Limit. It was supposed to be a character building music video that brings people together. We're trying to go with pep rally meets like kind of a bit of a celebration of different people. So you got artists, you got musicians, you got athletics, you got everything. And then they also wanted academia. And I believe you did the math equation. And then at the end of it, flip that marker up in the air. It even hit a couple balloons on the way down and you just walked away. I don't even know if the equation was right or wrong, but I didn't even care.
I was a drama kid that they threw into the math equation, so I
yeah.
But that was I just think that's hilarious. When we played that at our school's assembly, like that moment came up, and the whole school just went wild. And I was like, "That's great!
So, it's my life. You made his night."
Oh my gosh!
Back to everybody I know, so that's kind of cool.
That is awesome. What school did you go to?
Secord.
Amazing. There's another connection.
Yeah, so
how many takes? Yeah. A question from the Wild Woods.
I think that was two.
Two takes?
I don't know. I couldn't
two see. Takes?
Maybe.
We were running that day. That was a busy day.
Towards the end, so it was kind of probably tight at that point.
So that right there who's asking is Krista Ashford. She was a producer on Tales from the L Trail, also a fellow Secord kid.
Nice.
This world's very tiny, folks. Very tiny.
All comes together.
That's amazing.
Yeah,
you and I met at a church.
We did.
We were both the. You went in first, and you got the role for the Cube City Entertainment box idea. Like I'm building a box, but it's like I can't like messing up along the way.
And yep.
I remember meeting you in that.
Okay, I do remember that. We did have a connection though on social, right?
Yeah.
Beforehand, which like there are a few friendships I have or connections I have that I'm like, you built on social media, and that's when everyone's like, I hate social media. I'm like, well, I wouldn't know this person otherwise. But okay, so that was yes. Okay, that was a fun time. It was a silly short film. Did you ever see the end video?
Yeah, I'm curious how the whole. I mean, obviously, we were both in the same audition room and working with those that team. But I'm curious what that shoot was like for you.
I mean, any shoot you walk into is plagued with memories, which is awesome. That was one where, as an actor, you're making these decisions of do I overact this because that's what you want, or do I not? How real do you want to play? And so very quickly, I realized they wanted like big gestures, things that you're like, I don't know if this is going to play properly, but I'll give you what you want and trust the editing process. But it was a good day. It was just a lot of laughs, a lot of simple stuff. I vividly remember at one point I'm supposed to have a screwdriver and I'm supposed to throw it off camera. And they're like, I'm talking a big screwdriver. And they're just like, yeah, just toss it. I'm like, just like toss this like working like where? And they're like, oh, well, I guess we should throw a couch or some pillows or something. I was like, okay, yeah, that'd be great. Like, I could totally picture me like, whoosh, like I'm not athletic in any way. So even if you're telling me to hit a couch, I may not hit it. But yeah, no, it was a great time. Oh, that is, I do remember that now. Yeah. Oh, man.
Rolling down memory lane.
What was your audition room experience like for that one? Because I just remember me on the outside hearing some yelling, and I was just like, oh my God, what's going on in there?
Okay, yeah, yeah. I live auditions, it's a weird thing because I don't have a lot of humility. So they just wanted me to go crazy, and so I did. DRPX, hello.
Hello, hello. I had a good friend of mine who I would say is like one of the best actors I've ever worked with, like on our short films and stuff, Don Papa, and he was kind of trying to walk me through the whole, because it was no dialogue. It was just like you were miming it out, you were miming everything, and you were getting created. And the prep for that was, it was interesting because I'm not an actor, but like when the time comes, you become one, right? And you spend all your time thinking about it, and that's what you focus on, and you prep for that. So it was pretty cool to go through that experience. And now we have another connection. Wooden Spoon?
Yes. Savannah Oliver's short film, In Rain. I co-starred, or no, she was the star. I was literally just a side one. Yeah, yeah. That was a wicked time. You know what? It was a short film that I got cast in tail end of 2020. And it's a drama. It's heavy hitting about essentially like a woman's life almost imploding on a single day. My sister is on. Hi, Maddie.
Hi, Maddie.
I was so excited to do this. And I think we were originally supposed to film December, January. And then the cases started going up. And so it just kept getting postponed, which is just, you guys know, like there's a creative energy when you're like, we're planning, we're ready to go. We're like chomping at the bit. And we're just going to shelf this, just put this up here. We'll get back to it. And you're like, but the energy was so great because everyone's stuck in lockdown. And then you're on this project where people really care a lot to make something great, you know? And so when you, that energy on set is really a gift, I find personally. And so it was cool. I was only there for 2 days or 3 days. And it was a good time.
And you, I had heard that you were, you became a professional Scion driver through the process.
Yeah. Okay. So that is the most humbling experience of, no, probably not the most humbling, but it was a humbling experience. So they asked me, can I drive stick? And I said, no, I can't drive stick, but I have driven stick years and years ago. My wife knows how to drive stick. So she used to have a Mazda 3, fully automatic, standard. And so I had to learn a bit. And I hated even backing that thing out of the driveway because I was never confident. It's like every time I get into a standard car, I need to relearn. So we have this Scion, which is like an awesome sports car. First of all, it's also like up to my hip, I believe. So like when getting into that car, I'm like leaned back, like pretty much almost ready for bedtime, like tucked in with the steering wheel. So I took it out. I tested it. I'm like, you know what? I think I can get this going. And they're like, okay, we changed the schedule around. The first shot of this film, like first shot, first day, is going to be you driving this Scion up the driveway and getting out. I'm like, okay, yeah, I got this. And you get in the car and they have it parked on an inclined driveway, which, do you guys drive standard? No. Okay, so basically standard, if you're like on a hill and you have your brake on and you take your brake off, you immediately roll backwards. So then you have to put the, like, you know, push the clutch in, push the gas, kind of go up. If someone's like real, like behind you on your bumper at a stoplight on a hill, like you hate that guy. Anyway, so starting from a stopped position on a hill for someone who hasn't driven standard for years, it just like, and my character is supposed to walk out and be so cocky. This is the cockiest my character should be. I'm going to get custody of my kid. I got all this. And so it's like, you just, all right, and action, and it's just like unusable. You kind of like stumble out of the car, and it was fun. It was great. I love, you know, embarrassing myself in front of a bunch of new people I've never met before. Well, so day two, though, they actually go, someone else is going to drive the car in the wide, so you'll just hop in and just step out. I'm like, perfect, love it.
I thank Miss Rain Pakoda for sharing that tidbit with us. Wooden spoon when it's all done and said and done.
Yeah, I have no idea when. I think they're almost got a first cut on it. Last I heard, it was looking good. So,
yeah, I worked with Caesar on a project in the past, and he's great as well. So, lots of small world.
That was Burglar, right?
That was the Burglar. He was the second AC on.
Oh, that's awesome! And you produced that one, or were you on set?
Yeah, I produced that one. Like three years ago. 3 years ago this summer, I think. Yeah.
Kind of and that one's performed well at festivals, or?
Yeah, we put it around, and shout out to, you know, the director and producer and, you know, writers and or cop, who really just, you know, pushed and got it into some good festivals too, like the Toronto Black Film Fest, Montreal Black Film Fest, World Fest Houston, but like, yeah, world fests all over the world. But yeah, I mean, like, we had a really fun sort of way of finally releasing the short. We did a crazy just sort of like month countdown and did live streams and interviewed like the whole cast, and it was just nice. Like, COVID's been weird, but it's also been like, it's created opportunities for this online virtual sort of like red carpet ways, and sort of being able to figure out, you know, adjusting, but, you know, adapting and creating your own fun.
Oh, totally.
Like what we're doing right now. Right here, right now.
Right here, right now.
Right. You ready to jump in?
Yeah. Yeah, let's jump in.
I think he's ready.
Oh, what am I jumping into?
So we're going to jump in later. We'll jump in later. We're going to do the fun ones. Want to do the fun ones? Which ones are you referring to? Fun ones? Oh. Nick, what's your favorite word?
Oh, man. I always thought spatula is such a weird word. So that comes up a lot in my life for some reason. Maybe spatula. What's your favorite word?
Ooh, focaccia.
Oh, nice.
What is your least favorite of the words?
Least favorite of the words. Ugh.
Of all the words, what is your favorite least?
Right now, I'm hating the word hustle. Oh. Like, I hate overused words. So when people are like, oh, man, you just got to hustle, you got to do this, I'm like, I don't know. It's like, you know, when a word becomes something it shouldn't, you know, back in the 1950s, you're a hustler, right? And like that to me is more interesting. And now it's like, oh, yeah, hustle culture. It's, I don't know. So I'll go with hustle these days.
I resent the word now. So I loathe it.
Mm-hmm.
What sound or noise do you love?
Oh, you know what? I would say right now, this is going to sound really cheesy, but is my son's laugh these days is the best thing in the world. He has a multitude of different laughs, but he's just a constant source of goodness. So no matter what mood I'm in, if I hear that, I'm like, I'm lifted higher, you know.
What sound or noise do you hate or not like?
Your test.
That's a very good question. I don't know why. Like, my initial thought was like this. Like, I had one of our kids was sick last year, and I slept in the bed beside her, and hearing the sound of somebody about to vomit while you're in a deep sleep, that probably is my most fearful sound of the in the world. So I would go with that.
What turns you off creatively?
We could do a whole talk just on this alone, guys. Okay, right now I'm feeling like I hate working in an environment where people are shutting down ideas and not providing a creative solution. There is nothing, like, especially like I'm at the helm of a lot of idea generation. So it's like the idea starts with me. It doesn't exist. It's an infant. You can't squash an infant. You need to nurture an infant, be like, oh, I see some potential. It's kind of cute, you know, it's like, you know. So really giving that love and care. But like when you're in an environment where someone's like, ah, you can't say that. I'm like, okay, well then give me something better. Well, I don't know. It's like, you come up with it. You're the writer. You're like, well, no, like let's work together here. So I find like having that kind of resistance, because I'm all for creative collaboration when you're like, hey, I want this to be better. Or like, you know, if people put blind sites, like, you know, when you have blind spots on certain things that's going on in the world and everything, and someone's like, you know what, we should be sensitive to this topic. Okay, cool. So like, how do we do that in a successful way that still keeps the integrity of the project? So yeah, I would say that.
That was a good answer. On the other side of it, what sort of gets your juices flowing for creativity? What gets you going?
Oh, goodness gracious me. I honestly can get super excited about a lot of things. That's I think one of the things I think I'm naturally gifted in. For me, it's like being in an environment that I can create would be like the best. Like if you leave me alone in a room and we're like, hey, I'm just going to leave you for a week. I'm an extrovert, but I would love that. Like I would just be writing, creating, playing around. I love writing scripts and actually like going, like reading it aloud, like I'm a lunatic, you know, going back and forth. So, to me, it's like when you get an idea and you think it's good and you can catch fire and you can just add gasoline to that, man, it's wonderful.
Now you're talking our language as far as fire goes, stuff like that.
Wildfire. Yes, I know.
For sure.
Well,
what about you guys? Like what gets you going? Like, how do you, when you find yourself in like that sweet spot?
I think like, having, you know, your own inner sort of like, you know, monologue voice telling you you're creating right now, what you're creating, and you're there to create, you know, like that's your job and that's your role, is to create, you know, and you know, sometimes it's doing like 5 or 7 or 20 jobs at a time, especially if you're a one man band trying to film something, you know, or whatever the project may be. But I think just that sort of like, that voice of being like, you know, I'm here to create, and I'm doing my art here, and this is something that I'm you know, there's a reason why I'm here. That's the reason, you know.
That's good. I just thought too, there's an energy too when you're creating something, and you're like, I haven't seen this before, and I like it.
Ooh, yeah. Yeah.
You know when you get that shot, and you're like, I haven't seen this, or when I love it when you write a script and you're happy with it. You're like, this is a good script. And then like an actor or an actress comes on and they start talking in a way that you're like, I didn't envision this, but it's better now. And there's like a magic there that I just like watching. I just like, you know, I like that energy.
Well, it's been a while since I've sat and written or directed like thing. Obviously, it's been a writer's block take. Last year, just been fact of like consuming different kinds of media or films and kind of like different studying or watching whatever films I can. Just, that kind of gets me going, and then I'll maybe have down, or we bounce ideas off each other all the time. And
we got the board.
This is our idea board that's put up there. So
a lot of ideas up there.
We took them all down. We put them into a spreadsheet, and we're trying to organize it into a six-part sort of like crazy series. But as you can see from this, you get the egg.
I love it. is that a web series?
Yeah, a web series. I mean, you know, if it like a sketch comedy series.
Cool.
I would call it.
Now, are you looking to create something like for YouTube?
I would say, like, in an ideal world, I'd, like, try and get a broadcast or some form of thing and, you know, do it that way and do it big and bright and brutally great. But if I have to do it on a budget or no budget, I'll...
Totally. Budgets is the toughest thing, man. It's like you have to write for a budget or... You know, you're fighting tooth and nail to make something happen. We found with this season one of Tales from the L Trail, we wanted to do it a lot bigger, and so a lot of our producing time was trying to get extra funding and make it something amazing, and we ended up like I just found it was almost debilitating. It was like there's that producing aspect of it because all the hosts and Mark, who is the cinematographer, co-director. Krista, who's actually on here, she was producing. We're all like fighting tooth and nail to try and make something happen. And then when we got season two, we were just like, you know what? What if we just cut our crew down a bit? What if we just not do those extra shoot pickup days? What if we just not try and add that extra scene in each of the six episodes? You're saving six scenes. You're like, oh, like we can now just do it that way and enjoy ourselves. And it was like when I look at season two comparatively to season one, I like season one better, but because we gave a lot more, we had more budget, but season two is just more authentic and natural and fun. And I have a lot of amazing memories on set of both, but season two, it's like every day was a fantastic day. Whereas like in season one, some days were like, oh, we are killing ourselves to make this day. Yeah.
If God exists, what would you want to hear from him at the pearly?
Sorry, you cut out there.
God exists. What would you want to hear from him at the pearly gates?
You know what? I think if I could choose anything, it's just like, you know what? You're a good man. That is it, man. Like when all is said and done, like you just want to be decent to human beings creating fun stuff is great. But like, I don't know, to me, the richness of my life is the people that's in it. So like, I'm very blessed in that manner. So I would just hope that people would be like, yeah, he was a nice guy. Yeah.
What profession, rather than your own, would you like to attempt? I know you've got quite a few on your resume.
Dude, yeah. You know what? During COVID times, I've been getting into like watercolors, and there's been a few like acrylic paint. Like, I feel like if you left me alone in a shed every day and just I got to create art or like carpentry, that would be super fun. Glass blowing, I don't care. I like... Because I'm stuck at a desk all the time, the idea of working with my hands and standing upright and stuff, that would be pretty cool. Or teaching. You know what? That's another thing. I at one point I wanted to be an English teacher, drama teacher. I've gotten a bit of that actually with the DSBN. I did some Frames Film Festivals and whatnot, and I've gotten a few chances to work with youth who are passionate about filmmaking and learning or acting and stuff. And I love that. You know, the older you get, the less optimism you see in people. It's like you're kind of beaten down by life a bit. You know, it's like someone's like, I want to make a movie. And like a 40-year-old's like, yeah, but with what money? And 20-year-old's like, I don't care. I'm just going to do it. And 40-year-old's like, yeah, but what about your job? And the 20-year-old's like, I'm going to quit. And then I'm going to get a new job afterwards. And I love that energy. Part of me always wants to harness it. I think that's why I love being a dad. My kids, the world's their oyster. And it's a beautiful thing.
Well, going back then, how'd you get your start in filmmaking? Or what drew you to that as a means of expression or eventually a career?
Acting. If I summed up in one word, I was the shyest kid in the world. In elementary school, I had my best friend at the time, Jordan Jackson, who is in Toronto doing production. He wanted to try out for Oliver. He really wanted to be the Artful Dodger, and he did not want to audition alone. So he dragged me in. I did not want to go. Apparently, I was one of the few kids who could do an English accent, and I got cast as Mr. Brownlow. And so while everyone else is singing, dancing, and I just wanted to blend into the background, into the chorus, I was now like one of two kids who had to pretend to be old people. And I was like, oh, okay. And I enjoyed the process. I thought that was cool. And then in grade 7, I did The Music Man, where I played Marcellus Washburn, who was the comedic relief. And do you know, sorry?
I played that role in my own grade 8 production.
Oh, that's so awesome. The Shaboopy, baby. Yeah.
I don't get it.
So,
like, looking in a mirror.
I'm on the outside here.
Yeah. So Marcellus, so I wanted to be the music man, and I was in elementary school. I was about like this wider and poofier. I was not the romantic lead look. And I remember it was between me and Jordan again. And we had our teacher took me aside, and like, it was a very hard decision. And I know, like, looking back, it wasn't a hard decision. Jordan was fantastic. He was charming. He had this energy about him. He was the music man. And then they're like, but it was a hard decision. And we just think, you know, you both could be a good music man, but you would be a better Marcellus. So I was like, so that was one way of them really making it, you know, an easier blow. But I ended up loving it. I was just like, I got to be an idiot. People would laugh. And on the first night, and this is terrible to say, but I just remember walking out, like, during the curtain call. I was the third last one, and everyone stood up. And I was like, oh, they really liked me. And that was, like, kind of, it was very affirming to when you're in a comedic role where you're the idiot, where, like, I was, like, slapstick and people are laughing. Like, you could do that, and if you don't have laughter, your confidence will drop. So I think from that point on, I loved acting. And so I went to Laura Secord because of that, and loved those, like, it was such a wicked theater culture. Like, I didn't know music at all. That was where I learned music. Met some amazing people, and it was just a spot where it's like, you're kind of, if you think you're cool, you're not cool. And if you're just okay with being yourself, guess what? You're cool. You're cool in my books. And it just really allowed for you to thrive. I don't know. Was it the same kind of culture when you were there?
Driving everything. I went to Secord because of the drama program and, you know,
yeah.
And being in the choir and all that and music. And yeah, it was just huge. Yeah. It's very similar now, or at least when I was there, which is almost, well, like a decade ago now. So.
Yeah. Well, when I did the Frames Film Festival, like, the kids were the same. It was the same kind of culture. And I believe that really allows for, like, at the most crucial point of development in your personality, like those teen years, just a safe spot. You could just be yourself. Right. But yeah, so there was that. So I went to Toronto Film School, and that was like a 15-month intensive course where you just eat, sleep, film. It was an incredible time living in Toronto. I absolutely loved just like any night of the week, you could just go to a bar, grab a pitcher of beer, and you could watch live music. I miss that, especially in the pandemic times. I love live music. But yeah, and then I actually went there to act. And so I went to the film program thinking I could be more of an asset on set as an actor, who knows the background. And if I get passionate about something, if someone asks me to be a part of a project, like, I know I'm an asset. Like, I am a natural producer. I don't love I actually hate producing, but I will produce the shit out of anything. If I'm asked, if I'm given permission to, right? And so that led, and then directing. Oh man, I did not know I was going to fall in love with directing. Directing is just, it went, especially, you could tell a director who used to be an actor. or who has a love for acting, because they get it in a way. And I think that that's where it kind of became an asset when I was in film school, was I just got it. I'm not the greatest actor in the world, but like, it's like it, I kind of can get motivation. I can ask questions to dig deeper, and actors also know the vulnerability of creating like a safe space, right? So anyway, that's how I got into this whole thing.
Right.
Well, I think we should start another tasting. I mean, we've been working on the gun here. We've got the Lake of Bays double IPA with
crab. Cool. I make no promises. I have no idea if this is good or not.
Doing a nice Ooh. Pour. Oh, it's got quite a color here. For the viewers at home.
Okay. Oh, whoa. Yeah. It's biting. This is elderberry in it. It's a double IPA with elderberry from Lake of Bays. Do you know Lake of Bays at all?
No. Oh.
No? So they're up north by the Lake of Bays, right around Flying Monkeys area. Like if you keep going 45 minutes, they're up there. It's like a family run place. I've only been there once, and the person who's serving me was literally the owner's mom and dad. It was just a cool experience. Cheers.
Oh, sorry.
Ooh.
It's kind of like floral, eh?
Yep. It's got... It starts one way and then finishes very in a totally different way. And upon that journey, I feel like I've gone to a stream and maybe did a little dance. I don't know if that's the right way to describe when here. But...
Very earthy, are you saying?
Earthy, perhaps, mayhaps. I'm going to go with the celebrity on this one. I don't know. I'm almost feeling like this is like an Adam Driver.
Oh, you're good at this. Are really good at this.
Well, it's because you expect one thing and you get another. Like Marriage Story.
Mm-hmm.
Angry.
Marriage Story was exactly what I expected when I watched it. Did you have a different expectation for how that movie was going to play out?
I just didn't know he was going to break the wall.
Oh.
Oh, him specifically.
Yeah. I don't even know if he knew. He knew he was going to. That was rehearsed.
Well, Johansson was very frightened.
I know.
Yeah, the restraint.
Adam Driver, eh? Hmm. This one is like bitter. It's weird. I was expecting something fruitier, but there's more of a darkness in it. For some reason, I think Michael Shannon might be the guy for me for this one. There's something seedy and dark underneath this one, even though you have a nice name like Michael Shannon. Mm-hmm.
Miles, I don't know. No,
he's got a face that I don't trust, and he could be the nicest guy in the world, but that I feel bad for him because as an actor, he's just constantly cast in like evil roles. There's just something about him.
Right. I wanted to go into our next segment, which
let's do it.
Sort of a Niagara-centric segment. Just some of your recommended or favorite locations to Niagara. So I'll give you sort of the description and you can sort of fill in the blank on which location.
Okay.
So what would be one of your best locations for a low budget film shoot?
Oh, a low budget film shoot. What are we shooting?
Nikon. No. It's a, let's say it's a Star Wars parody.
Oh gosh, a Star Wars parody. I'm just gonna go with Malcolmson Eco Park. Like you can get like a forest vibe. It's easy to get into. You can roll a dolly in there. You probably don't need permission.
Best location for an epic rap.
Probably the wall right outside Mate.
With all the phones on the phones.
Yeah.
What about for a beer show near a river?
A beer show near a river. I'm just going to say Breakwall Brewing Company. I mean, it's a canal, but it's close enough. And I just love Breakwall Brewing Company.
What about a wine show near a lake?
Wine show near a lake. Conzelman.
Nice.
It's right off, right by Lake Ontario.
What about for a commercial that is super high budget but needs to stay indoors?
Super high budget commercial that needs to stay indoors. How about any listing over $1 million in the
bottle?
Yeah, we'll do that.
Best nature spot near Glenridge.
Sorry, what?
Best nature spot near Glenridge.
Am I supposed to say Burgoyne Woods?
That was the setup, I suppose.
Okay.
I saw Burgoyne in, I believe it was the Tacos? White Boys. I saw that you guys had shot.
Yep. We shot there a couple times.
I lived just right by Burgoyne, so I'm just very familiar. We've shot there many times.
We filmed a werewolf film there late at night one night, and we're running around in a werewolf costume. Good spot.
Nick dropped the camera.
Oh, nice. We've all been there.
I didn't. You didn't?
I was carrying the camera, and I fell, but I saved the camera.
Oh!
I wiped out, but I saved the camera.
I didn't know. I was the werewolf, so I was running after you.
Amazing.
Best look.
Nick, it looks like you have an admirer. Happy summer. 426 says you are so cute, oh. Mr. Glasses.
Oh, thank you.
Can we do like a little show, like just kind of bat those doe eyes? There you go.
Thank you.
Oh yeah.
And we keep it going. best restaurant to shoot.
Best restaurant. I'm gonna go with. Oh shoot! I've shot in too many restaurants. We did a short film at Cafe Amore. So I'm gonna go with Cafe Amore.
Best spot to have a crowd scene.
Best spot to have a crowd scene. Grape and Wine Festival.
So yeah, Montebello. Best place to film an action scene, like an epic chase.
Yeah, I mean downtown St. Catharines has got a few alleyways, a few like spots that could seem a little dangereux.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Best place to shoot an animal video.
Okay, I heard cannibal video.
Cannibal video.
Animal?
Well, I said to shoot an animal video.
Okay. I heard to shoot a cannibal video, which I would give you a totally different location at that point. If you're doing an animal video, just go to Happy Ralph's.
Nice. True. Good spot.
Best location for a wedding venue.
Best location. I like Oast. Oast is pretty cool. Their patio is lovely.
Well, speaking of Oast, where's the best place to host a pig roast?
Why don't we just go with Oast? Who want a pig roast at Oast? I feel like just based on the name, you have to go with it.
One stop shop at Oast Pig Roast. All right. I'll host it.
Best concert venue. Or best place for a concert?
In Niagara? I'm like, immediately I go to all these places that make me so happy, and because of this pandemic, I just get really, really sad. So that's just tough. You know what? I'm going to say my living room. Because we actually hosted a concert in our sunken living room at our house, and our house is not designed for that, but it was probably one of the best nights. So,
last but not least, where's the best spot to go on a romantic date with your wife of 30 years?
Of 30? Is there a wife of 30 years that I don't know about? Did I get married at 5? You know what? My wife and I celebrated 11 years last May, and we grabbed Counterpart Takeout, and we went to what was it? What park is that? Oh no, I'm now blanking on the park. It's off Jordan Road.
Jordan Park.
Nope, that would be a good one. Anyway, whatever right. park that name is, I'm blanking right now.
That's fair. That's fair. We are drinking beer, so that's part of it. Well, we kind of touched on a little bit from the Snail Trail, but it'd be cool if we could jump right back. We were watching episodes last night, and we were getting super into it. I worked on Corkscrewed, the wine show that was shot. So I've got that as sort of a reference of a show that I worked on, but now jumping on over and seeing what you guys did, it's like the whole different thing. It's beer. It's not wine. It's beer.
Totally.
I was just super, super, super thrilled to see how awesome your clients were, the guests, the beer makers. They were so upbeat, and you guys got really great performances out of them. Obviously, you know, the three of you guys have a great chemistry with one another, and you know, you're playing these versions of yourselves, but also there's like other aspects to it, I'm sure, as well. And you know, there are improvising in there, but at the same time there's some planned stuff too. But just in regards to the performances of the, because when I was on Corkscrewed, I was always the camera on the winemaker, so I was like trying to learn the whole time. I really enjoyed that part. So I don't know. I just wanted to say, I just thought you guys did a really great job with your show, and kudos to you guys for killing it.
Thank you.
How did that sort of idea sort of like come together? Like, what were, was it the three of you guys were just like, we want to do this? Or like Bell 5 was like presenting? How did you get the show greenlit? How did it come to be? Where the guys were? That's a lot of
great story. So Drew and Chris are the other co-hosts, and there's Mark who's behind the camera. We pulled him in front of the camera in season two. My favorite thing in the world is putting Mark in front of the camera, because he hates being in front of the camera, but he's such a good sport now that he will, like, it's not even a fight anymore. He's just like, oh, sure, I guess. It's like, and he is, I find him funny. So there's the four of us, and we do an annual cottage trip, go up to, it was Chris's parents' cottage, and we have a few beers. There's one time where Chris was just kind of in a job that he absolutely, it was soul crushing. Like, the job was good. He just had a boss who was like terrible, like just a mean person. And so I was like, well, this is me. I'm like, if you can do anything, what's your dream job? Obviously we had a couple wobbly pops beforehand. And he just goes, I don't know. Like, I'd love to be in front of the camera and maybe do something about beer. And so we just started spitballing, and eventually we flew with the idea of like Tales from the Ale Trail, but like an approachable beer show. Like, we didn't want it to be like, if you look on YouTube, it's like people who would dissect this in a very like sophisticated, scholarly way, and we were just like, no, like, let's just like beer culture. Like, yeah, it's delicious, but really, it's about like connecting with the people you're with. If you go and visit a brewery, normally breweries give you a sense of place. So the food culture, the beer culture, even the people who own and run it is really indicative of the geography, like the community that they're in. So we naturally love that stuff. Like, our excitement about that is high level. In the beer industry isn't one where you're like, hey, we opened up a brewery and we made $1 million. So it's a lot of people who are passionate about what they're doing. And it's easy. I find that it's easy for me to get passionate when people are passionate. So it's a natural thing. So we actually had a huge project, commercial project that we lost out on. Like, we lost out on by I want to say $760 some odd. Like, our bid was just slightly higher than the person who got it. And they're like, well, we wanted you to get it. I'm like, well, then, but it was a government thing. And so we were super bummed. It was going to basically make our year. And instead of doing that, I had Paul Gardner from 5TV1. He reached out to me at one point, and he's like, hey, a few people have told me to talk to you where we need a show. And I you know, in this industry, I get called all the time, like, hey, I want video production, but I want you to pay for it. And you know, like, So I was like, oh, yeah. And like, then I found out, like, oh, Paul's legit. Like, he actually wants a show and he actually knows our content. It's not like, it's like, hey, do you know a guy with a camera? Well, I'll send you to Jade. Jade's got a camera. He'll be able to help you out. And so anyway, so we pitched Tales from the L Trail, Chris and I, and Mark was away on a trip at the time, and they loved it. They gave us the green light, and off to the races from there. And what we wanted to do is we wanted to do that foodie show, but we also wanted to do, like, my dream would be to do a show indicative of like a Parks and Rec, Brooklyn Nine-Nine, Modern Family, like something in that mockudramedy where you can journey with characters over like a while. Like I like seeing a character who is high strung winning, and then I like to see in the next episode of them out of their element, and then I like, you know, like I like the flow. So I just selfishly wanted to infuse as much of that kind of humor and style into this as I possibly could.
We were watching Beer 101 season 2 episode 1, I believe. Mm-hmm. Within a few seconds, I was like, Schitt's Creek, mockumentary. Like, it has that style to it. And it, like, yeah, I was kind of drawn in quickly. So that's awesome.
That also, it made shooting super easy. Like, when we knew, like, hey, we're starting this way, we kind of want to end it here, we can do a scene here, and then the rest is like whatever organically happens.
Yeah.
It allowed for our day to be like, you know where you're heading, you know where to drive the conversation and where to land it. So that there was a method to our madness. But in terms of like getting people comfortable, like the beer industry is awesome. It's just down, like the majority of people are down to earth, passionate people. And it's so easy to connect with them.
Well, in regards to what you and your co-hosts were having to do, which was react a lot of the time, what you were drinking or what they were saying to you, and sort of in line with acting and sort of the whole sort of like, is it an over the top thing or is it a subtle thing? We wanted to take that sort of model and then ask, is there an over the top beer or a subtle beer that you had tried on Tales from the Ale Trail? And if brewmasters were actors, which brewery teaches the Stanislavski method? Well, which one is more of a Meisner?
Oh, goodness. Okay, so part one of that question, hit me with that one again. Which ones were the beers that were over the top and which ones were understated?
How do you have the right reaction when, like, on camera to, like, a beer? Were there moments where Mark was like, okay, we got to get a better reaction? That reaction was too subtle or not subtle enough, you know, or too over the top or not over the top enough?
Okay, so the benefit of having three hosts, we all like different beers. So typically, if there's a beer that someone like reacts really positively to, they probably really like that beer. You're not seeing the other guy. We just, it's editing magic. I'd be like, all right, well, we're not using Nick's cam because he obviously, you know, or there was this one, like Chris was notorious. So Chris, he likes a lot of saisons, light beers. He has a good palate, but like if it's very heavy, like if it's like a heavy hop beer, that's not Chris's forte. So I always knew like something like this, he would be like, eh, like it's, he'll drink it, he'll like it. And Chris is like one of the most, he's a sweetheart. So it's like all polite and everything. But he would be like this. Yeah, that's interesting. And yeah, that's interesting. I always knew, oh, Chris isn't going to be describing this one. I'm like, he's out. So yeah, so for the most part, what you see is actually what you get. Like, we're not blowing steam up people's butts, thankfully.
Right. And then in regards to what were some of the over-the-top versus sort of subtle beers that you tried along the way?
Over-the-top. I'll just go with over the top. So when we were at Clifford Brewing Company, that was our third brewery of that day when we were doing a pub crawl. So if you watch, I believe it's episode 6 of season 2, we're very over the top. And I wouldn't say it's fake, but I would say it is beer influenced. So everything tasted great at Clifford. I mean, it normally does. Clifford does great beers, but it definitely was influenced.
Just kind of a highlight reel of what were some of your favorite moments to gather away from the Ale Trail for you.
You know what? We wrapped up season 1 on a beach doing paddleboard in Port Dalhousie. It was one of the most beautiful sunsets. It was probably one of the most fun days. We did yoga. We did, like, it was just an easy day. It was surprisingly easy. We started the day on a sailboat. I mean, who, like, when you start a day on a sailboat, it's going to be a good time. And I just remember, we're in these stupid wetsuits. And I'm like, I felt like a salami. I was just like everything, my beard was like popping out funny. We had to take off the wetsuits, but the change rooms were locked, which this really probably should have made the show. So Drew and I are stripping out of these wet, when I say stripping, it's like peeling, but slowly, because it's like pushing all our dad bod fat up. And the guys are just like laughing hysterically and taking pictures. And then we had the wrap party. So I was like, you know, that's a good time.
Well,
oh, sorry. I was going to say, there's also a moment in the Albino Rhino Beer Festival where we did a musical number. 2 days before the festival, Drew and I wrote a musical and we're like, you know, we should do this. We're filming at a live festival. What more complication can we provide? Let's do this musical number. And so we wrote it, and Drew throws me under the bus. He's like, well, Nick has no humility, so he'll be the one who does this. And at one point, we literally have a speaker. It's blaring. Nobody's warned at this festival. And I have to jump up wearing white pants, a white shirt, white rainbow, white glasses with like rainbow things. And I'm just singing to my heart's content. And I hop off this bench, and we have to do that like 5 times. And it's just, it's one of those moments where I remember hopping up there the first time feeling a little awkward about it, and then like immediately the second time I'm like, I think there's something broken in me that I have no embarrassment that I'm doing this right now, and if anything, it's just a good time.
Right. I think one of the questions I want to ask is just, you know, do you aspire to be a solely feature film director at a certain point, or do you think that is somewhat limited, somewhat archaic, I think, in this sort of multi-hyphenate model? I'm just curious about what your thoughts are on sort of like, you know, doing everything versus doing one thing. You know what I mean?
Oh, totally. Like, I do a lot. I still act for sold points, like running I'm an accidental entrepreneur, because I never plan to be doing commercial video production. My heart has always been into narrative films. I'd love to be making things that kind of transform the way people's hearts view the world. So if they can kind of be more grateful for their lives or the people in it, like that's the kind of the content that I would hope to create. So I try and infuse that as much as I can in our commercial work, and in the same breath, like I try and do that like with comedy. Yeah. Comedy would be the one where it's like, oh, the world's a better place. No, I just want to make you laugh and be stupid. And if I can do that, that's awesome. But no, like I would love to make a feature film. That's like the one bucket list thing that I haven't, I've been a part of it. Like I've been a supporting actor. I've AD'd a feature film. I've written feature films that have almost been made. And then I've just pulled the plug. Just because well, you guys know, like creating a feature film is a massive undertaking. And I feel like, so Chris, who's a business and marketing major, he always says like, he teaches business. He doesn't do business. And he goes, I would love to start a business, but I know too much about business to to start a business. And I feel I've reached that point in my life, unfortunately, where I'm like, I know too much about filmmaking to know that if I did a feature, like, it would require an insane amount of sacrifice, not just for myself. Like, I'm happy to work hard, but like for my family and from anyone on the crew and their families and livelihood. So I would love, honestly, I would love to write and direct a feature. But I don't know if I could do it unless I'm like compensating people properly at this point.
Yeah.
It's a tough thing to ask that favor and that sacrifice for people. And so like I this past year I was like runner up for a feature film to be a lead, and I was really bummed that I didn't get it. Because I was like, oh, it was up in Muskoka. It was going to be 2.5 weeks. It was a dark comedy. I'm like, this is all the things I love. So I wish that something like that would have happened. But yeah, I would definitely direct something if I felt like it would be, I don't know, at this point too, I don't want it to hurt anybody who would be a part of the project, if that makes sense.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Yeah.
That's kind of a depressing way of putting it, eh? Like, they're gonna be like, "Yeah, I want to make a feature film. I have this idea,"
and it takes so long. Like, I mean, we're experiencing it with Wildfire, with doing all these visual effects, and like, you know, what we currently have now is like a fine cut of, you know, like a good indie drama with like some comedy in there at times, and it's becoming, you know, sort of this like action drama that has way more stakes. And because the effects give that benefit. So it's like, they're not effects just for showing effects, but they really do amplify the drama seen on screen. So it's like, it's just crazy undertaking, man. Like, kudos to Greg Holmes. Shout out to Greg Holmes for, you know, putting in a paper. This guy don't stop. Don't stop. He goes every day. Visual effects.
It's good.
Putting it from scratch. So he'll be the visual effects guy in Niagara, even though he doesn't want to be.
Well, and you have to have a love for it, right? Like, if you're looking at the VFX, like, that's a big thing. Like, I have a feature film that I wrote that I was really happy with, actually, the script. It's called Scraps of Happiness, and it followed a guy who was diagnosed with cancer, and he's dying. And that is basically, that is the whole story. There's nothing groundbreaking with it, but it's funny, it's charming, it's romantic. They're at the end of it, you're going to cry and you're going to laugh. And that's basically the whole point of it. And I thought that would be a cool, easy one to do. There's no VFX. It was going to be this guy, his best friend is a wedding videographer. So he hires him to crew it and basically video his whole life. And that was it. That's the whole thing. So it's forgiving, right? Like, if things go out of focus, if you hear and you don't see, it's kind of okay. And it's like, so I wrote it deliberately to be like, hey, can you film this in like 2 weeks and be done? Probably, right? But at the same time, there's like a cost to that, right? I don't know.
Yeah, it's a funny industry to find ourselves in. I'm having these conversations more and more, trying to navigate my own way to try a producer or like get funding for a thing. Just like, oh my God, there's just so many things. But it's fun. I mean, it is fun and it's meant to be fun. We're trying to make fun.
You got to keep doing it. Like, are you guys familiar with Mark and Jay Duplass?
Yeah.
The Duplass. So there's a book called Like Brothers. Amazing book. Check, read it or listen to it if you want. But those guys have an awesome story of being nobodies who basically work together to, you know, make an indie film. Their route you can't do nowadays because they kind of did things before everything was accessible with DSLRs. And they were like Sundance darlings and all this stuff. But the principles that they have for their filmmaking, they almost can't shake their indie filmmaking. Like, if you look, they have a couple of films. Blue Jay is one of them on Netflix, and Paddleton with Mark Duplass and Ray Romano. And they're both, if you look at the cast and credits, I think 15 people.
Yeah.
And to me, there's something beautiful and romantic there. Like, I've been on sets where there's like 30 people. I'm like, 22 of you are doing nothing. and why are you here? Like the film industry, I get, is like unionized for a reason, but there's a beauty and a magic of indie filmmaking when an actor who's not acting is like, you know what, I'll prepare craft services, that's okay. And you know, there's something nice about that.
I love it.
Was that the experience of Wildfire? Like, you guys had a small crew, intimate cast, right?
Went up to a place called Tom Ray Lodge in North Bay, which our lead, Mark Matthews, his aunt and cousin, like, run these like 7 or 8 cabins, like fishing cabins up there. And so we had the really fortunate opportunity to go and get 2 cabins. So one was a crew house and the other one was film house, like, you know, set. And so we basically, yeah, we hunkered down. I think it was like the most that there was like 10 people, I think. Mm-hmm. Like, but I mean, it was just Nick, myself, and Greg, which were the crew. And then Samantha, who was one of the cast members, sort of became our Swiss Army knife on crew, which was super duper. Wow. To have one person come, like, from being an actor, and then she has no more scenes. And she's like, well, I'm just going to stay with you guys for another, like, 3 or 4 days and help out. And it was like, she was doing continuity, helping Nick boom. She was doing, like, camera assist, doing, like, props. And it was just like, yeah, I mean, it's crazy just how everybody
and everyone would put help something prepare into food and,
you know, help clean up after. Oh, it was a heaven on earth for 2 weeks. Like, it was stressful.
It was the most stressful vacation.
How many days? How many weeks were you up there?
We were there for 14 days straight, and I think we shot for 13 of those 14 days.
Oh my gosh. You need it's hard, eh? Like, you need a breather. It's like you need 5 days, 2 days off, like, just to, because when you're done shooting, there's batteries, there's data management. It's, if it's only the three of you, like, you're doing it.
It was
when you're not filming.
It was real. Like, it was like being in a different world, because we were also looking at the dailies with the actors every night and like right in, like, we're, you know, criticizing and figuring like all the funny problems and things that we had to. So there was a lot of really good sort of juju going on that whole experience. Like, you know, that everybody was given a little bit of to one another, and I feel like everybody helped each other. At the end of it was like, oh my god, it was like coming home from summer camp. It was coming home. It was very a little depressing. It's like when you finish watching one, sad when it's over, but happy it happened, and you'd love to do it again, and you don't know when you're going to do it again. That's the thing.
Oh, I know. It's crazy. And you kind of, especially with film projects, like it's weird. Like Wooden Spoon was my latest one. And it's like, you show up for 2 days. But like, for me, I was like show up, I'm the antagonist. I had a couple meetings ahead of time virtually, and you show up, you film, and it's done. Right. But this is a film that Savannah, who's the director, was dreaming about for 2 years. Right. And it has borrows from her experience and from her research. And you're like, oh, like that's it. It's kind of done and over. But there's a beauty of almost in this industry to be able to focus on a project, be like, hey, this was our film. We finished it. We're editing it. We're tying it a bow. We're going to promote it. We'll probably promote for the rest of our lives, let's be honest. But what's the next project? And I always find like that's the healthiest thing you could do as a creative, is to make sure that you always have like something that you're excited to be a part of creating. Like there are ideas in my head that have been in my head for like years, and they might see the light of day. They might not, you never know. But it's always nice to kind of be working towards something, I think. I don't know. From my standpoint, I'm always writing and creating. So it's like, I always feel like responsible, like, oh, it's my job to actually create something. So it's always nice when it's like, oh, hey, you need an actor and I fit the role. Great. I can just join your project for a bit. This is awesome.
Well, I'm looking forward to when we work all together in the future, because I think we have maybe, but it's like, let's do it. Let's make it happen. And this has been a lovely, this has been a lovely time chatting with you, man. Like, thank you for taking the time out of your
Tuesday. Oh my goodness. This is great. You know, the only fear I had was kids' bedtime, but we got them done. Oh my gosh. One pineapple IPA. There you go. I'm still on this one, so I'll be nursing this one.
I'm trying them all because we're Tales from the Elbow. We're doing it. Oh, I can smell.
Got to do it. Got to do it. So let me ask you, gentlemen. So what is it that you're like you're working on this web series? Is that something that you want to promote, or is that just kind of like a fun project that you're just playing around with?
We're having fun writing. Well, Jade conceived this and then comes to me for maybe some like punch ups or rewrites or stuff, and we bounce it around. So I don't know. Is it still in the development stage?
Yeah, I mean, I've sort of reached out to a few people to potentially cast, but it's very, very, you know, I want to make sure that the written word is the best it possibly can get and show it to people. So it's still in the writing phase, but we've got, like, skeleton, 6 episodes, like 2.5 of them written already, so we're 3.5 away, or, you know, and punching up those 2.5 as well. But it's called Portals. Is the title the word?
Sorry,
title.
Say that again.
Portals.
Okay, I saw Greg posted. He said portals, like as a comment.
Yes, Greg.
Ad nauseum. And so the basic idea is, you know, your COVID's got us all down. You know, you're sitting at home. You wish you could go and just enjoy the beach or something along those lines, and. This is a new sort of like, you know, prototype software you can install via an app. It's free and you can just click and go into a portal. That was the original idea. It was just like, I'm going to actually create portal technology. Like I talked to my boss and he's like a pretty like tech wizard. So like, he's kind of like, oh, really? actually.
Yeah.
About this Windows screen technology and, you know, your portal technology, that kind of makes sense. And then I was like, well, I'm shopping around with investors right now. So if you want to get in, like, you know, it's now or never, okay? But no, and then it turned into a few skits, and I've like shot like one of them and I put it up on TikTok. It's now turned into more of a each portal is like a different world of in crazy, just lewdish, absurd, in the like sort of like Eric Andre meets. A dead hooker meets, you know, like zombies meets werewolves.
Literally anything.
I work for a production company called Buck Production. So one of them is a parody of them called Butt Production.
And is this like the Twilight Zone meets Black Mirror in a weird way, but it's a comedy?
Kind of, sure. I mean, some of the films that Butt Productions have put out over the years are such classics as Forrest Rump, Plump Fiction, and Eric Butkovich.
Fair enough. Shaving Ryan's privates, we get it.
Like some guys come in to let pitch, and they're like, oh, we like it. There's just not enough butts. So we're working on it.
Fair enough.
Well, thanks for listening, Nick.
No, I love it. It's wicked. It's funny when you start conceptualizing an idea. Like I've been mulling over an idea to pitch, where it's essentially like this couple who deliberately travel to haunted Airbnbs or haunted areas. But they have relationship dynamics because I can't just do a horror film. I'm like, it needs to be comedic. And so they're always getting into these situations where like there's hauntings or whatever, but their relational drama and life dynamic just gets in the way of them actually experiencing it. And that's kind of the comedy of the whole thing. So that's like what I'm...
Deal with this relationship thing right now. This is more important than what's going on.
Yeah, or it's like, yeah, like it could just be a very simple thing. Like, you know, I just don't understand why, like, when you take my toothpaste, you put it in a different drawer. And meanwhile, like, this is happening. And meanwhile, what they came for with the paranormal activity is happening, and they just can't see it because they're caught up in their relational dynamics. And I don't know. I just think it's stuff like that's fun. So
awesome. Well, I think this is the time where we give you the floor to do any of your potential shout outs. Anything else
you want to hear you saw throughout the
Cheers to you, man.
Thank you. I don't know if I have any shout outs, you know, like we got Tales from the L Trail. If you want to watch it, watch it. It's stupid. It's fun. It's not the best thing to watch in a pandemic because you're going to miss going out to a restaurant and seeing your friends. So it's like the worst. Hey, go watch like Three Idiots. Have a great time while you stay at home and not have a good time. So there's that, but yeah, no, this has just been a lovely time. I think it's really cool what you guys are doing to promote Wildfire as a feature, and also just what you're doing to build connections and to promote the art community. This is really wicked, guys.
Yeah, man.
I honestly, like, with what you guys are doing and what the effort that Greg's putting into the VFX and to get behind a project, I admire that. Like, that a feature film has always been something that I've yearned and desired to do. And so anyone who actually does it, films it, finishes it, it's like, it is, I think I tip my hat to you, cause it is not easy. And it's worthwhile. It's worthwhile.
Worthwhile fire.
Yeah.
Well, it's a long way to go, but we're going to get there. And, main thing is thank you for your lovely candor, this good sir. It was.
Thank you.
I keep just, you know, repeating, nice. But it's nice. This is nice. This is nice.
You know what? I promise when this pandemic is over and we can do this in person, we should get together, bring Greg out. Like, let's just have some bro time. That's romance. Sweet. Let's do it. Well, I know you guys get each other all the time, but.
Too much.
Gotta get out of here.
We need a break. Well,
the only person I see. It's crazy.
Oh, God.
Hey, there's Matt.
Matt.
It's a good, we balance each other out, which is good.
Mm-hmm.
Go from a spectrum to like most extroverted to a bit less extroverted. And Jay's definitely the top of the. He's.
I call it Stockholm syndrome. Like when I have a bubble, like I work with Mark and Drew, who are like two of my best friends, and I work with them. And so when the bubble opens, you're like, oh, I guess I'm working with my coworkers, and we're like, I vacation with my coworkers and I hang out with my coworkers. I'm like, do I have any other friends anymore? And it's like, my wife had to remind me the other day. She's like, no, it's like, we're not allowed to see people. You're only seeing the people you're allowed to see. I was like, Oh good. You know, it's you know, you two are each other's person.
Yep. Well, my best friend's keeper. All right, Nick,
thanks so much.
Nick
and Jay.
Thank you guys. This is awesome. So nice to hang out with you guys.
Well, have a wonderful night, and all the best to you and your wonderful, beautiful family over there, and to
thank you.
The whole MRP team, just shout out to you guys for, you know, building a really cool, sustainable thing in Niagara as a production company. That's not easy to do. And, you know, good luck with your future stuff, and hope to keep us in the loop, and if we can be of any help for a phone call or an Instagram live stream away.
Perfect. Thanks, bye-bye. Guys.
All right.
Take care, eh? See ya. All right. See ya. Bye.
See you next week.
Okay. Bye.
Bye now.
Bye-bye now.